together today. Thank you that you are the King of Kings, you're the Lord of Lords, and you have made us your children. God, we thank you that you're making us new creations in you. We thank you that the old is gone and the new has come, and we ask that you help us to walk in that today. I know there's things that entangle us and distract us, and so we just ask that you'll, by your power, you continue to free us from sin and selfishness and the things that would distract us from your kingdom. Help us to not build our kingdom, but to build yours. God, we thank you for the message of reconciliation that you've entrusted to us. God, we need your strength and empowerment by your Spirit to share the gospel with the world. We ask for opportunities to do that and ask that you will just open our hearts and minds to show us how to share the gospel with the people around us and to continue to be made new in you. We love you, God, and we thank you for this time. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Good morning, church. Good morning. Will you stand if you're able as we worship together this morning? Psalm 57 says, "My heart, O God, is steadfast. I will sing and make music. Awake my soul. I will praise you, Lord, among the nations, and I will sing of you among the people. For great is your love, reaching to the heavens, your faithfulness reaches to the skies. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth."
Thirsty, come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Come all you sinners, come find his mercy. Come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only his son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. Bring all your failures, bring your addiction, come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting there. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. The power of hell forever defeated. Now it is well. I'm walking in freedom. For God so loved. God so loved the world. Praise God, praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, praise him, for the wonders of his love. Sing praise God, praise God, praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, praise him, for the wonders of his love. For God defeated, the power of hell forever defeated. Now it is well. I'm walking in freedom. For God so loved the world. is waiting. God so loved the world.
You believe that this morning? Amen.
In the darkness we were waiting, without hope and without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, oh praise forever to the King of Kings. To reveal the kingdom coming, and to reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation, you did not despise the cross. For even in your suffering, you saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation. Jesus, for our sake you died. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, oh praise forever to the King of Kings. Morning that you rose, all of heaven held its breath, till that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who come to the Father are restored. And the church of Christ was born, then the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel and shall not faint. By and blood and in his name, in its freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King.
Just lift your voices, praise the Father.
Praise the Father. Praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. Oh God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. Oh, praise forever to the King of Kings.
Promise is faithful.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy and love. Beginning to end, my life in your hands. Great, great is your faithfulness. You never let go. This one thing I know. Beginning to end, my life in your hands. Great, great is your faithfulness. Never let go, this one thing I know. Great, great is your faithfulness. Beginning to my life in your hands. Great, great is your faithfulness. Lord, you never let go. This one thing I know. Great, great is your faithfulness. Oh, great, great is your faithfulness. Faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have need in thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord.
This is my surrender. Here is where I lay down every lie and every doubt. This is my surrender.
Here is where I lay it down.
Here is where I lay it down, every burden, every crown. This is my surrender. is my surrender. Here is where I lay it down, every lie and every doubt. This is my surrender. And I will make room for you to do whatever you want to do whatever you want to. And I will make room for you to do whatever you want to do whatever you want to. Here is where I lay it down, every burden, every crown. This is my surrender. This is my surrender. Here is where I lay it down, every lie and every doubt. This is my surrender. And I will make room for you to do whatever you want to, Lord. Do whatever you want to. And I will make room for you to do whatever you want to, to do whatever you want to.
You may be seated.
tissues need to be everywhere, apparently. Anyway, may it be so that Jesus is all I'm chasing now. So we are going to do our missions moment this morning, and we went to Vermont last week, recently. Everything's been swirling, so it's been a busy week or so. So we went to Vermont. We're going to be able, we have a, just a short video of some slides we'll be able to share with you. Excuse me. And anyway, we, every morning we would have breakfast and Isaiah would say, thank you, thank you, thank you. So I just want to share that with you all. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Our church has supported Love and Care Ministries for a long time and they so appreciate that, and then they were so thankful to have us come in person to be with them. So wonderful young couple, you'll be able to see some pictures of that. It's a quick video, so it won't take forever. Lizzie put it together, I thank the Lord for her. And Sue took the pictures, so it was just, the team came together as the Lord made it happen. So I just praise him for that. In the video you'll see there's a church building we were helping to remodel. So when you see the church ceiling, the sheetrock, that's two layers of sheetrock. So, but got all done by God's grace. So you'll see that, some yard work and, window removed, fresh one put in, new siding up and painted. So pretty amazing just how the Lord worked that together. But if I could have everybody who went on the trip who's here today stand up, I would appreciate that. That was wonderful. We had a great team, and there's more. Lizzie and Josh went. They're seated. Anyway, I just wanted to give a quick opportunity in case anybody wanted to share something briefly about the trip and how it blessed them. Even if you want to do it from where you are, that's fine. Anyway, it was a great trip, so we can play the video. Thankfully, Anthony's good at that too. you. So as you can see, we had a whole bunch of things going on, a whole variety of ages. I just feel like I could so clearly see how the Lord put the group together and all the skills that were needed, and people just kind of ran with projects, and the Lord made that happen. So it was a step of faith to put the opportunity out there, and God just worked it out. So I just want that to be an encouragement to you. And everybody just had a great attitude. It was just beautiful. So it was the Lord's work. So that's, I just thank you and appreciate this church's support. We collected some money. We were able to give Isaiah and Taisia that money. They were just so grateful. And since we were there, do we have that picture too? Yes. They had their baby girl. Aww. I still don't know her name. I meant to find out. I'm so sorry. But she had her baby like days after we left. So, yeah, that was amazing. So, anyway, there you can pray for them. So now I just want to be able to introduce my sweet friend Marissa, who's here again. Who was here last time she came and spoke? Yeah, so a bunch of us. Plus we've had a video from her and her husband, Billy. So, but she's able to be in the States again. And so we have the opportunity to hear some updates. I know sometimes you hear a story and then you're like, okay, but what happened? So now we can hear more of what happened. So I'd like to invite her up, and she's going to be able to share with us how things are going.
Good morning. It's so good to be back again. Thank you. Thank you so much, all of you, for welcoming me and for praying, because I know Rachel tells updates and she shares with me that you pray for us, and that means so much to us to know that you are caring for us in that way. And when I found out, it was kind of last minute this time that I found out I was coming back, so I called right away to Rachel to let her know and ask if she would want me to come back and share, because I just want to say that God is amazing and he is doing so many things that I'm so excited to share with you about today. So I don't have the clicker. Am I supposed to have the clicker, or can I use it? Okay, that would be great. Thank you. Me and the clicker didn't do good last time, but do I go to the right to make it go? To the next one? To the left? Just start hitting buttons, okay. That's what I did last time, and I don't know, we were like back and forth, so I'll do my best. Okay. So last year I showed you that we had began working with the Myanmar people, the factory workers and migrant workers' children who we were teaching who couldn't go to school anywhere else. So we were teaching neighbors and Myanmar children. This year, our school has more than doubled in size. We have almost 60 children, and we have parents waiting outside our classroom begging us to take their children into our classes. We have asked the factory owner if she would give us more space, and she gave us the next room over. So we now have two small rooms that are our classrooms that are absolutely full of children that are coming now. So these are children that we now are teaching not only English to, but we now have two teachers that are Myanmar who are teaching their language to them, to read and write their own language, the Burmese language, and teaching math to the children. And we are also teaching Bible to them on Sundays. So we have multiple things that they're learning, as well as music and songs. So in English class, David and I teach singing. We teach all kinds of Christian songs to them. They know everything from the ABCs to God is so good to this is the day that the Lord has made. And it is amazing to hear them sing and love to do that. So our classroom, that is our second classroom now. Our first classroom, you can see some of our teachers in there. And I can't wait. I'm not going to spoil this story. I'll get to that in a minute. But we have two teachers. Now, the one that you see on the left is not teaching for us anymore. We have a new teacher that I'll explain about in a minute. But God has filled our classroom, and the opportunity that we have is just growing to reach these students, their families, and all of them in their community with the gospel because of this. So we're really excited. So our adult English classes 1 year ago that we were teaching in our home several nights a week is Our English classes now have grown. We have 25 to 30 students on a regular basis that come Monday and Tuesday night for English classes with us. My husband mostly teaches those classes. I teach sometimes. When he's away, I teach all of them. But our class is full. It's busting. And those same students we invited on Wednesday night to come and hear the Word of God, because we gather as a church gathering on Wednesday night. So all of them very regularly show up on Wednesday night as well. At least half of them every Wednesday night are there. They know it's not English class. They know it's studying the Word of God, but they want to be there. They want to hear. They ask for Bibles. They read their Bibles throughout the week. These are Buddhist students who are coming to hear the Word of God. They know that we love them and we care about them, and we open our home to them every day almost of the week. They show up, stop by, eat with us, hang out. They want to sing worship songs to God. That is what they want to do with their free time when they're with us. It's amazing. It's so exciting and amazing. So worship in our home last year, and that is us packed into the classroom that we teach English in next door to our house. We have to break down all the tables twice a week. We just put mats on the floor. That's how we worship. Everybody just finds a spot on the floor, and we jam as many people in as we can. We're up to almost 50 bodies in that room, one room, on a Sunday. That would be Wednesday night with our students studying the Word and worshiping. So that's our Sunday mornings right there with all of us on the floor. After that, we have a big lunch together. We feed everybody, and they stay all day. So we enjoy it. We love it. It's kind of nap time on the mats after that. If you're going to stay, we're going to take a nap. So we'll see you after nap time. And they all hang out. They play guitars. They sing. They play games. Then they're like, are you going to take us to the beach? And it's like, okay. So then we try to load as many people as we can into our vehicles. And let me tell you, we can load people into those vehicles. We have a 16-passenger van that we have fit probably 26 people into. Yep. Then we have a truck. We traded out our other truck. We got another truck that we put bench seats and a roof on that you can like load people in. And we can fit about 20 people in the truck to go to the beach. And so anyway, Sundays, that's our crew at the beach. So they love when we take them. We don't always take them, but at least probably two Sundays a month we take everybody to the beach. So it's good. It's more fellowship time we can have with them. It's more time just interacting, talking about the Word. We always bring our guitars. They want to sing. They want to sing more at the beach. I mean, it's amazing. So last year, I introduced you to Sister Zion. I told you that she was the refugee lady who we were going to be starting a home for refugee children with her. So God hugely answered this prayer, and she moved into the first house that we got for her, and we heard that she was going to be getting 5 refugee children to live with her. She called us and said, is that okay? I got a phone call about these children. Can I take them? We said, absolutely. We'll send you the money. Take them. So she first had 3 adults, and 5 children that moved in with her. That quickly changed. We got another phone call. Can I take another 3? Can I take another 2? Can I get up to 20? Do you mind if we go to 22? So we were like, whoa, okay. So she's maxed out for the year at 22 children that she now has in our refugee home. That was us last week with them. We spent the week, my family and them, and some of our other friends drove up there. It's a 12-hour drive from where we live to up near the border where they live. So we are renting a house. The Lord provided a new home for them that was even bigger, that's in a safe, secure place, that's fenced in. There's a Thai family that owns this home that is protecting them, giving them protection because the children are not legal. And we have been praying that God would provide legal status for them, that God would help us to care for them, give them schooling. What is the best way? Zion has been teaching them at home, basically homeschooling all of them. And the Lord has provided the means for them to go to the migrant school, which is right by the border. There's a huge Christian migrant school there. And God provided the funds for these children to all go. Let me give you an idea of what that costs. Per child, per year, is $60. And they couldn't afford to go to school. So someone donated generously for all of those children to be able to go to the migrant school for the next year, which is amazing. That will also give them a school card, which will give them a somewhat legal status, which the Thai government will accept for them to be able to live there, which is amazing. So there'll be more expenses on top of that for uniforms and books and things like that, but in general, that's what it costs for a child to go to that school and have a full education. So we're super excited. They start in another week. They'll be going to school. So every day, every night, these children are hearing the word of God, and Zion and Sister Cuckoo are the two ladies who care for them. There they are. There's Zion on the right. They're holding my babies. And Sister Cuckoo is her name, and the two of them, every day, they're cooking for the children, they're sharing God's word with them, they're training them in English, they're teaching them school, everything they can. Every night, they do devotion with them again. They're singing, they're hearing the word of God. These are all children that came from Buddhist homes. They are all starting to understand about who God is, that God loves them, that they can be safe and cared for. And some of these children were even taking refuge in the Buddhist temples and being cared for by monks because they had no parents. Many of the children had to run and flee from their villages. All of them had to flee from the villages they lived in because of the war in Myanmar and how dangerous. Parents were literally calling to Zion saying, please, we heard you have a safe place. Will you take our children? Please, will you take our children? So they can be safe. So we're just so thankful and excited that we were able to find this home for them and that we're able to just let them live there and be safe. These children have nothing, just nothing. They only have what people donated to them to have in this home. And when you ask them, how can we pray for you? We talked to them last week. We said, what can we do? Like, what else can we do? How can we pray for you? All they say is, we're just so thankful. We're so happy to be here. Thank you that you give us a place to live. Thank you that we can be safe. We don't have to be afraid. One day we were there, and I laid down to take a nap. It was very, very hot, and no air conditioning, you know, sleeping on the floor, just very different than life as we know it. But to them, the house is amazing that they're living in. They never thought they would live in a house like this. So I'm laying down on the mat sleeping because I'm so hot, and I hear very loud helicopter sound going over the house. I jump up, just like, we're right near the border, not very far from the border of Myanmar, and there are bombs being dropped and war over there. These kids ran from that to save their lives. So I come running out to see the children rustling and afraid, of course, because the sound they hear of the helicopter, and my husband's telling them, it's a Thai helicopter, it's okay, you're safe. It's not anything to be afraid of. It's just a reminder that they are safe, that God has brought them to that place. God has given them protection, and now they can hear about him. They can know about the God that loves them and wants to save them. So praise God. Praise God for that. So that is the girl kneeling down, and the girl to my left there is Sister Sandamo. She is another Myanmar lady who regularly travels across the border. We've been in contact with her now for 2 years. She shares the gospel everywhere. She goes to the people who fled their homes. She tells me, she'll say, hey, sister, I got to bring some medicine. Do you have any money for medicine for these people? Or these people don't have food. There's people that don't have food. Do you want to help me? I'm going to go tell them about Jesus today. Like, she's fleeing across all the time, back and forth, trying to, like, help these people. So every time we go, she spends time with us. And this past time I actually crossed the border with Sandamo and Zion and myself, and we were able to bring a whole truckload of food across to orphans and refugees on the one side that we had already made a connection with before. We were very passionate about helping people, but we very much want to do it in a way where we make connections for the gospel with these people. We don't want to just drop food and never see them again. Of course, we want to feed them, but we want to have places that we can establish the word of God, that we can have people there pouring into people's lives and establishing a group of believers. That is our hope and our goal, whether it's on the Myanmar side or the Thai side, whatever. So pray for that for the future for us, because there's so many people in need. You can't feed everybody. You can't help everybody. But every time we're there, we hear more and more. This group of people, that group of people, they don't have food. They don't have food. These children, they're hiding in the jungle. I mean, that's life there. So, oh, wrong way. See? So this is us, one of the times that we crossed and we brought food. There are people living, that is, many, many people live in a home like that they make themselves after fleeing, and then they have to find a place to live. So they gather bamboo and leaves and they make their homes. So that's an example of where many, many people would live and sleep on the bamboo floor there. So God is calling his people to make disciples. He has always been doing that. And we're excited because as we've shared our story, we have seen many people have answered that call and have felt the Lord calling them to go. And whether it's short term or it's longer term, I just want to share with you very briefly about the people that God has brought to us. So you can see Travis. I told you about Travis. He had just arrived from Pennsylvania. He sold everything he had and he decided to come and join us. He is now speaking Thai amazingly. He's been learning full-time Thai since he got there. He now has a lady who visited, and they have been in contact from America. She came and lived with my family for a month while she came to spend time with Travis, and I believe there'll be news about that soon. And there they are on the left. So Travis is still eagerly spreading the word of God, working with us. Praise God for his life and his sacrifice to just leave everything and come. It's been amazing. And we absolutely love Tiff. So, yes. So excited about her. So then you can see to my right there, that is one of my very good friends, my husband and I's very good friend, Eric, his wife, Jessica, and their children, their three children, came for almost 7 weeks with us. And they came in one way and they left a different way. So they are in the process of selling what they have and planning to move to Thailand with us before the end of the year, Lord willing, to share the gospel. So praise God that he is working in his people. And you can see there's Eric and Jess in the middle, and the really blonde kids are there. So you can see in the picture. So then I will show you next. Sorry, I can't make it go next. What am I doing? Oh, there it is. Okay, so the other blonde people you see there, that's my husband's sister sitting on the floor there. So last year, right when I came, they had just left. They had spent 9 months living next door to us in Thailand. They came with their four children, and they helped and watched and decided they would take a year, they said, to kind of pray and see whether it would be for them. Then they left. They didn't really tell us what they were doing, so we weren't sure. They went back to America for a year and prayed and sold their house and everything they own, and they just moved back to Thailand this month. So that was unexpected and amazing, and they even have my niece, who is special needs. She's 18 and special needs, and they don't care. They just said God is going to use them to spread the gospel where the gospel is not. And so they're currently living in Thailand, just praying, asking God where they should live, in what area. So praise God for that. So the Myanmar community of people has welcomed us in. They have told us that they, at first, were a little hesitant about us. They thought we just came to brainwash them. But now they believe that we truly love them and care for them. And so they have welcomed us in, inviting us to every event they have, all of weddings, all of birthday parties, regular meals, all the time we have invitations from them to join their community. So that's an example of a meal we were invited to at one of their homes. And that's us by the lake where they live. There's a whole housing area behind the factory, and we go and play and hang out with our students and their families regularly. So it's been a huge blessing because they are all very strong Buddhists, and they know that we are very strong Christians, and they are open to hearing from us, to having us be part of their lives and to listening to the gospel. So praise God. At Christmas, I know Rachel already shared this, but we went to 14 different homes sharing the gospel and singing Christmas carols. And they were almost all Myanmar people who lit candles, put lights on, and waited for us. They waited for us. Houses were like four doors down, and I thought, why don't they come listen over here? Nope, they wanted you to come to their door and sing and do it. So we would sing all five of our songs and present the gospel and pray for their home, and then the people would be like, okay, we're next. So we like walked down like 10 feet and we had to do the whole thing again. It was like, okay, no problem. So that's what we did, and it was literally until 1 a.m. I thought, these people were in bed and then would get up and come outside and open their door and put the lights on to listen to us. So it was amazing. It was really, really cool. Like nothing I ever experienced. So anyway, went too far. Sorry. So many people are hearing the word of God. You can see those young men there. Some of them are just so close. Like when I say they're like dangling on the edge of like, we will follow Jesus with our life. They all have Bibles. They come faithfully. They're asking questions. They're praying. They're asking God to open their eyes to the truth. And they love to study God's word and worship God. And they would all say, we're almost there. We got to just say everything else isn't true and this is the truth, and they'll openly talk with us about it, and we never want to push someone for an answer. We don't want them to say they believe because we tell them they should say they believe. We do not do that as we present the gospel. We just tell them, ask God to give you the strength. Ask God to open your eyes. Pray to him. Study his word. And we watch it happen, and we have seen, this is the most exciting part. Since I was here last time, we have seen three people completely give their lives to Jesus on their own like that and change and say, I know Jesus is the only way, and I will spend my whole life telling people that. So this is Lo Si. She is 15. She came from just deep, deep darkness in Buddhism. And she was one of our very first students we taught English to, and she told us that she could see evil. She could actually see evil. She said, when I walked in the first time to your classroom, I looked, I couldn't see it. She said, I couldn't see evil in there. It was like, I couldn't find it in your eyes or in this place, and I knew something was different. And she would listen and listen to us share the gospel and the word of God. And finally, after months, she came to us and she said, I'm gonna follow Jesus with my life. I am not Buddhist anymore. She said, I don't believe that. And she told us that when she decided to follow Jesus, she cannot see the darkness anymore. Praise God, he rescued her from scary, awful dreams, awful things she saw. She was so afraid she couldn't sleep at night before. And now God has saved her. She shares the gospel with people. Mo, I don't know if you remember Chai and Mo. I told you about them last year, but Chai was the very first English-speaking Burmese Thai-speaking person that we prayed for, that we met. That is his girlfriend, Mo, that is Chai. That's Chai and Mo. So Chai was the very first person. When I got back from my trip last time, he had come to the Lord. When I arrived home, I got the news that he had come to know the Lord. And he is the happiest person I know. Literally, that is his smile every single day. We are with him every day. Every day I see him, he has the biggest smile, and you can't not be happy when you see Chai. And anyway, he moved separately from his girlfriend when he came to know the Lord on his own. They had been living together for 3 years. She moved in with David next door to us, and we just prayed. Everybody prayed for Mo that she would come to the Lord after Chai did, and he said, I won't marry her if she doesn't. He said, I can't. I have to follow Jesus. So anyway, several months later, Mo came to the Lord. They still chose to live separate because they knew they weren't married yet, and they both have been baptized since then, and 2.5 weeks ago, we just married them. So praise God, they both have come to the Lord. And they both, that's Mo being baptized there. So that is amazing. So we visit people, we share the gospel, there are sick, there are dying people that we spend time with on a regular basis to share God's word. And praise God that that is what we are able to do. The last thing I'll share with you is very, this is one of the rubber farms. That's where Losi lives. So Losi is the girl who came to know the Lord, and she said to me the day I visited her, I'm really sorry, I'm taking a really long time. I just looked at the clock. So I just want to tell this story really quick. She told me how scared she used to be when her family moved out there. It's literally in the middle of nowhere. You have to walk really, really far into the rubber farms, and it's very scary, really creepy. The trees are like, it looks like a horror movie when you walk out there. So they tap the trees for rubber at night. You have to work at night when you're a rubber farm worker. So going out in that forest at night when it looks really scary is even more scary. So her whole family, they have about 2,000 rubber trees they have to tap every night. And anyhow, I visited her. That's her bedroom. She showed me her room where she lives. And she said, when I moved here, I was so scared. But now I know God's with me. And she said, I know I don't have anything, teacher. She said, I don't really have anything. But I have Jesus now, so I don't need anything else. That's what she said. So praise God. Praise God. I'm gonna skip for time's sake. I'm gonna skip ahead, and I'm just gonna share really quick. Wow, that's really small. I'm sorry that came out that way. So I just want to share really small, really quick about our financial situation, because people ask us all the time, because we're not through a normal missions organization. We didn't raise funds to go. We literally just liquidated everything that we owned, and that is how we moved to Thailand. So that is what we lived off of. My husband is also in the Army Reserves, so he does fly out and do his drill time every couple months. He's gone for several weeks, and the kids and I stay, you know, behind. So he brings in an income of only $20,000 a year from his Army Reserves. So our family, though, the size that we are with 9 children and all of the ministries that we told you about come from us. So we live off of $50,000 in Thailand for our whole family, for Zion's House, for the schools, for all of the people that we support. And the money can go so much farther in Thailand than it can in the U.S., so you can stretch the dollar a lot, and God has provided. And when we look at this, we can see we have donations that come in every month to around $900 right now. That is not our expense amount, but we give that right back out the door to Zion's House, and that's what pays for the children and all of those things. So as we get from people who want to help us, we are able to give more. And that is how we want to live. And we're trying to teach our children that we can live with less so that we can give more. Because every day we see people there who need and who don't have. And if we don't have as much, they can have something. And that is what we're trying to teach our children and our with our lives. So I just share that with you to say we have been blessed with one-time, very generous donations from people. Multiple times that has happened, and that is how God has provided what we need. And our numbers don't match, as you can see. What we spend doesn't match what we get. But that's okay, because literally God provides. He answers our prayers. We can't explain it, but we have money. And the Lord provides as we need, and we just praise God for that. Every time something comes in, someone donates something, it's always at the perfect time, and the Lord knows, and we trust him. So praise God. So I will just ask how you can help. Pray for us. Please pray. Continue to pray for us. We know you already do. I'm not going to spend much time on this, but someone, send someone. We have so much work to do. We have so many people that need to hear. We need help, honestly. Pray. Don't think that you can't do it. That's all I want to say. Don't think you can't go. Because I thought I couldn't go because I had chose to be a mom and I had all these crazy kids and I thought, there's no way. I can't even go on a mission trip, let alone be a missionary. Like, never. I just absolutely thought I couldn't do it. But when I just gave that up and I said, God, if you make a way, I'll do it. We did. So I just want to say I'm not anybody special. My husband's not anybody special. We just love Jesus. We just want other people to know him, and that's all. So if you love Jesus and you want people to know him, just ask God how he would use you. Don't say you can't do it. Just say, God, what do you want me to do? That's all I want to say today. God answers prayers, and he is so faithful. We have seen when we walk according to his will, like his word says, he will answer. He will answer, and he does. So the last slide, I will just ask, you can pray for us. If you want to take a picture, if you have a cell phone, then you can remember the things to pray for us. Maybe that would be amazing, because I'm not going to go through all of them again. I just want you to snap a picture if you can. And and the very last thing, I will also ask if you want to take a picture. Sorry, I'm not clicking right here. Nope. That's not. I'm done. That was my last slide. Never mind. I thought there was another one. There isn't. Okay, thank you. Thank you for listening, and I will pray for you, and I thank you for praying for us. So praise God for all he's doing. He is so good.
That's how I roll, too. When I run out of slides, I'm done. That's all there is to it. Oh, I missed it. Somebody can text that to me. We can get that on the weekly prayer list. Wonderful, wonderful message. Thank you very much, Marissa, for your time with us, for your message, and for your faithfulness. My goodness. I've got a few, couple of things. If you feel God calling you to give to the Ola family today, you can certainly mark a check with the Ola's name in the that little space down below, and we'll make sure that she gets it. If you feel as though God's calling you to that, we can certainly do that. Thank you all so much for helping out yesterday. We had a great work day here, and that was just. If we're not ready for kids' church just yet, hold everything. A couple of things that I wanted to mention. If your kids are getting a little scutchy in the service and they're hollering things out and having a ball, please, we love it. We can go toe to toe with them. If you've ever served in a church that has no children, it's music when you hear the kids. Kind of squirming around like that. What else did I want to mention to you? Oh, you know what? We have an opportunity to do the baccalaureate again for the eighth graders at Chichester School. So that's back on in about a month. That's awesome. Great news. Baptisms, baby dedications. If you feel in God calling you to be baptized in obedience to our Lord, please let me know, because we have baptisms coming to a pond near you, our picnic, or this afternoon, wherever you want, we can do it. We also have a new procedure for dismissing our children to Children's Church. So now that our security team is up and running, we feel confident that our teachers can get our kids 50 feet down the hallway, and everything is going to be fine. So from now on, what we're going to do is have the teachers for Kids Church stand in the doorway. The preschool to first grade will be on my left, and then the first grade through second through fourth will be on the right side. And if you want to go back there with your kids, I know sometimes their sermons are better than mine, so you can feel free to do that. Or if you are a parent who has never signed their children into Children's Church, you should probably go back there the first time to make sure we have the contact information. So at this time, the teachers and the Children's Church kids can line up in their appropriate classes, and your teachers will march you right back there. doesn't look like marching to me, but I had a different picture in my mind of this. But that's okay. We'll get it. First week. All right, guys. We'll see you in a little while. You know what I'm going to do? I send an email out on Mondays that has the scripture for the following week. And tomorrow I'm going to attach to that a link to an interview with Benjamin Netanyahu, okay, the recently elected leader of Israel. Great. It's a review. It's an interview with him discussing his new book, My Story, it's called. And the reason I want to bring it to your attention is because he does a great, great job of making the case for Israel's right to exist and to defend itself. So it's really important, because the more time you spend with younger people, you realize what they're being taught about Israel. And we really need to be able to interact with people that are being taught that Israel does not have a right to exist or a right to defend itself. So I'm going to send that with you. And if you're not on our email list, please fill out that Connect card that's in the chair ahead of you and drop it in the offering box, which is by the back door, and we'll get you on that list, and you can get all the updates that the church has. So if you have your Bibles and your outlines and your pens with you, you can grab those. If you're missing a pen or a Bible, there's some right by the back door. If you're missing the outline, we do some fill in the blanks here. There's some out in the foyer. Thank you so much, missions team, and thank you so much, Marissa, for sharing two of the avenues we have as a church to go out into the world and make disciples. You know, we're working through the Sermon on the Mount in the Gospel of Matthew right now, and if you flip all the way to the end of Matthew, those are Jesus' last words in that book. You know, go forth and make disciples. So, you know, what we've seen two examples of already is how Christians can do that, but there is an even more important understanding of missions that we're going to look at here today. It's a missions trip that all Christians embark on when they get up every day and go forth from their house into this fallen world. You know, Christians' mission is not just writing a check, although that is a part. It's not waiting for your church to organize an event to go somewhere, although that's a part too. You know, many Christians push off this calling onto people who have dedicated their life to missions, like Marissa and her family. Many Christians feel that they're not gifted, or they don't have time, or they're too busy, or they don't know enough to be able to be missionaries. Now, we're going to see today that God does not accept those excuses. Missions is a calling that is absolutely and completely linked with the faith and the new heart that God has given us. Now, we have no valid excuse. At one time, Queen Elizabeth was sending an ambassador far away on an important and difficult business to the country of Mauritania, right? And that ambassador, he objected, saying to the queen, "But what's going to happen to my family, my business, my home, my obligations?" And Queen Elizabeth said, "You take care of my business, and while you're away, I'll take care of yours." And he went out to the capital of that city, Nouakchott, and did a great work for England. And the queen cared for his affairs better than he ever could have if he had stayed home. And that's really what God is speaking to us here today through these verses we're going to be looking at. And that's the one thing that I pray that you'll take home for you, with you from this sermon, is the fact that God has given his children new life with a message, a mission, and a manner. Right? And let's take a look at that in the book of 2 Corinthians 5. And we'll start 17, which I think is a verse that probably you are familiar with, but you may not have realized the baggage that it carries with it. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. All of this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. I'm kind of guilty of that myself. I know I throw 5:17, 2 Corinthians 5:17 around like a frisbee sometimes around here. You're a new creation, but like I say, there's baggage that comes along with that. Being a new creation is not an end to itself. When you're given that new life, you're also given new desires and new delights. And our scripture here says it's the message and the ministry and the method of Christian missions. And God wants us to be equipped. So he reveals four aspects of it that is going to help us on our journey. And the first is that all Christians are a new creation by God's own hand. Right? Anyone that is in Christ is a new creation. The old you is gone, the new you has come, and this is the work of God alone. Before you take one step towards missions, before you utter one word in the name of Christ, you must understand exactly who it is that's doing the work and who will get the glory with any results. Right? Our salvation and our new life is a work of God alone. It's by his hand, right? So not only does it have the power, it's his energy is expended getting this done. And I'll turn to another go-to verse, right? Ephesians 2, 8 through 10. Paul says, how and why? For by grace you have been saved through faith. This is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no man may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. This is so important because the field that you're going out to, whether it's your neighborhood, your workplace, or Tanzania, is going to be a place where God is not known and therefore is very capable of discouraging you and wounding you. This calling will drain you if you believe that the salvation of others is up to you, all about your eloquent speech and your persuasive ways. If you're believing that, the missions will eat you alive. Look, Paul wrote to the same church earlier in his ministry, right? He does a great job of explaining this. When I came to you, brothers, I did not come proclaiming to you the testimony of God with lofty speech and wisdom, for I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I was with you in weakness and in fear and trembling. My speech and my message were not in plausible words of wisdom, but in a demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith might not rest in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. All of us need to enter into this calling on our lives with a peace that comes from knowing that God will work in someone's heart according to his providential plan. Right, that understanding is going to give you the freedom to speak as the Spirit leads you, and the comfort in knowing that it's not up to you for the results. But what is up to you we can see in the following couple of verses, in verses 18 and 19, all Christians are a new creation with a God-given message. The second half of verse 18 and into 19, right? Christ reconciled us to himself, right? He gave us new life. He gave us the ministry of reconciliation, right? In this new life, we serve God by serving others with this offer of new life in Christ. God does this by entrusting in us this ministry of, this message of reconciliation, right? We're given the privilege and the responsibility of sharing the gospel. But we need to know it. But if you've received it, you know it. It's your testimony, right? I was this, then Jesus, now I'm this. It doesn't have to be any more complicated than that. Reconciliation, right? It's the restoration of a relationship into a harmonious state where it was broken before. It's the message of the gospel. It's the good news that even though a person is a willful sinner, God loves them. He's made a way for them to be reconciled with him forever. But while he desires all people to be with him, we choose in our natural state to worship ourselves and oppose his perfect plan. That's sin. People in sin are lost. Right? They're separated from God. And that sin creates a penalty to be paid, just like any law that's broken. Person in sin, person that's lost, wandering the world, no purpose, no direction, trying to fulfill their life in every possible pursuit without success, right? Career, hobbies, drugs, relationships, but it's all empty. Just move from one to the next. But God sees our struggle, and he loves the people of this world so much, he sends his son, his eternal son from heaven, to be born as a man, to endure the torture and the humility of remaining to be fully God, but also being fully human. And as that God-man, he lived that perfect life in perfect obedience that we choose not to. And then he offered up that perfect life as a substitute in death, in payment for our sins on the cross. So that when we turn from our old lives, when we repent and trust in him as our Savior, his perfect righteousness is given to us. Right? That the beginning of our new life. And God declares us not guilty of our sins. All of them. And gathers us to himself as a child. Reconciled forever. He places his own spirit inside of us to guide and comfort and empower this new life, and we remain in fellowship with him forever. That's the message of reconciliation. That's the message that we receive, that we accept, and we're given to share. We're entrusted with it. We're entrusted to share that with the lost people of the world. Could Jesus just knock people over and blind them and speak to them personally and bring this message of reconciliation to them in a way they could never deny? Absolutely. But he chooses to use us. There's a lot of reasons for that. I can share three with you. Number one, he knows as we do it, we will be more conformed to the likeness of Christ, which is what he desires. Another reason is that he's glorified by this, by our obedience. And it also draws us closer to him as we share that message of reconciliation with others. Like, God works through us like we would build a treehouse with our son. Okay? If you just wanted to end up with a treehouse, it'd be a lot easier if you left him inside watching SpongeBob, right? I mean, you get it done in like a quarter of the time. Swinging on branches and chewing on the nails, you know? But that's not what we want. We want to build it with him. if you left him inside, you'd be missing out on all that growth and joy that developed between you two when you're together doing it. Right? This is exactly what God's talking about here. And that's the point he makes in verse 20. That's our next point. Christians are a new creation with a God-given ministry. Right? We're ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. We are ambassadors for Christ. Right? An ambassador is a representative from one people group sent to another people group to be a spokesperson, an example, a bridge builder, an authorized official with a specific role as an intermediary between these two groups. And God's not telling you you might be one. God's not telling you if you work real hard, he'll make you one someday. He's saying if you're a Christian, you are one. And you're either doing a good job of portraying Christ or you're not. People are going to meet you, they're going to see you, they're going to hear you, and they're either going to see an accurate portrayal of a follower of Christ with a message of reconciliation, or they're going to see something else. And if they see something else, it's going to be a reflection of what they already have, so why would they want what you have? Just because it has the name Christ attached to it? No. Your mission is to show the new life God has given you and show them that it's available to them as well. Right? Your mission is not to convert, convince, or cajole. It's to faithfully represent God's kingdom and to testify to the power of God. And then let God work in their heart. That's it. You're not responsible for the results. You're just responsible for obeying this command to be that ambassador no matter what. Have you ever heard of Dr. Livingston? Right? Famous missionary to unexplored Central Africa. Everybody thought he was lost. He was never lost. He knew exactly where he was and what he was doing. Once he was sent a letter from a missionary society in England saying, "Have you found a good road to where you are? If so, we want to send other men to join you." And Dr. Livingston sent a message back saying, "If you have men who only come if there's a good road, I don't want them. I want men that will come whether there's a road or not." Right? It's not dependent upon human or worldly obstacles that could be in the way. Right? There's no loophole for this. We don't need to concern ourselves with obstacles in our way. God takes care of the obstacles. We just need to concern ourselves with obeying this command. Right? That's our final point, is how he wants us to do it. All Christians are a new creation with a God-given manner. Verse 21, "For our sake he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God." Right? Interesting here, okay? When you take these verses we're looking at, that while the verses show our message in our ministry, right, verses 19 and 20, they're sandwiched between God's sovereign work and providing what you need to get it done, okay? Our new life, verses 17 and 18, and our new manner, verse 21. Our manner as an ambassador is that of being in Christ. That's what he means by becoming the righteousness of God. Right? It's the righteousness of Christ that God sees in us when we trust in him for our salvation. Right? And we're reconciled to him through faith. Because in Christ is the only way that we can be loving and be fearless and be that kind of ambassador, right? Carrying this message to people that don't know him. We can't do it in our own nature. It has to be in Christ. As the righteousness of God. Right? What God is saying here is that we can't duck this. You can't get out of this assignment by thinking that you're not worthy because you have worth in Christ. You can't ignore this call by saying you aren't qualified because you're qualified in Christ. You can't pass on this mission by believing that you don't have the strength or the knowledge because you have all the strength and knowledge needed from Christ who placed the Holy Spirit in you on that first day you believed. All four of these points close every possible loophole and scrap every excuse you could ever use to ignore the calling of missionary on your life. You know lost and hurting people. You know people dying in their sins. You have the cure. God has given you all you need to live out this part of your new life. There's nothing in these verses that even remotely describes mission as an optional part of this new life he's given us. I hope that you all get to experience the joy of seeing someone you've led to Christ be reborn. You can do it. I just read it. Our obedience to the scripture is twofold. First, it's a personal plea to any here who do not know Christ as their Lord and Savior. You are being offered new life as a new person right now by God. At this moment, you can start your life over and begin all over again by surrendering to God's free gift of that new life. Christ's righteousness draped over you and being reconciled with God forever. Your old life, your new life will be nothing like that old life. You'll have new desires, a new perspective on everything. There'll be a new family of faith to walk through it all with you, and a God that will never abandon you or leave you without everything you need to be victorious. It'll cost you nothing to enter into his kingdom. But once you are there, you will offer him everything in thanks and adoration. If this is your decision today, we'll be praying for you and with you in just a minute. The second challenge of these verses pose is to all of us that have received that new life. Where is your mission field? Who are you an ambassador to? A neighbor, a cousin, a friend, a co-worker? It's someone. And you've got the bookends, right? You have new life. You have the righteousness of Christ. The message and the ministry, right? Those verses in the middle there is what you need to think about. Be prepared for this calling on your life because it's not optional. God is going to put you in that position. Your new life has a gospel message. It has a life-saving mission and a Christ-like manner. Submit to God's call on your life as an ambassador for Christ. See what happens. You're going to find that all the things you worried about neglecting are already in God's capable hands, and he's going to care for them better than you ever could, right? Just like the ambassador on the first bus to Nouakchott. Let's close in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we don't need to accept your call as missionaries because you have made us ambassadors with the new life you've given us. We just pray that we would be worthy of this calling, that we would understand it, we would undertake it, we would boldly go forth. Thank you for these scriptures, Lord, that hang new meaning on a verse that we thought we knew. I just thank you for being here with us and helping us to understand this calling. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. And we are going to say goodbye to our internet audience in our new camera location that doesn't give me heartburn thinking about people tripping over the cord. Thank you.